Welcome to another Phase 4 Pep Talk. What succeeds? What is it that succeeds? Familiarity. What's the secret to success? Familiarity. We call this moving our comfort zone. Every day we move our comfort zone even further, even closer, even nearer. Another way of putting it is we get closer and closer to opening our eyes and seeing what's already there. Familiarity wins. Familiarity wins over everything else. It's not about conceptual acumen. It's about familiarity. Which is why monastic life is the way to go, actually. And I would say monastic culture. Okay, this is a broader spectrum. Monastic culture is what we need. Now, a lot of people think about, oh, I'm too scared of monasticism. Understandable. But you're not too scared about an overall monastic culture, are you? See, that's different. There are many niches in the monastic culture. It's not just isolation for 20 years and meditating, okay? Some will do that because they're ready for it, they want to. But a monastic, overall monastic culture is the right way to go to ultimately accept that there's never been even an instant of existence, not even one instant. And no one is exempt from this realization because no one is separate from reality, right? So it's impossible that anyone ever be exempt or be an exception from the necessity of realization. So it's just a matter of you realizing that it's something you have to do. You have to do. It's like if you want to stay alive, you need to breathe. Most of us. And so you have to breathe. Most of us have to eat. So, there's the absolute necessity is realization that time, space, process, form, existence never happened. Never happened, never will happen. It's never been the case. Never. So, what wins? Familiarity wins. Monastic culture gives you the opportunity for familiarity. Gives the opportunity to break bad habits, to gain good habits. Gives you the opportunity to come in contact with those who have succeeded. So ultimately, what we're doing is preparing for monastic culture, preparing for realization, socially, preparing for a more monastic culture, okay, which is not happening in this world so much at all, is it? We'll see how it plays out. But familiarity is the winning strategy, which means putting time into it, blocks of time. Blocks of time, a consistent practice during the day, just to keep reminding yourself, but more importantly, blocks of time is the key to it. 1 hour, 2 hour block of time, 3 hour block of time. Doing that several times a day, ultimately. This is the monastic life, is simply having blocks of time where you pay attention to truth. Okay. Rather than say a 5-minute prayer, that's helpful too, but also blocks of time. Now, in a monastic culture, this is supported all the way down to the householder level, you see. So if you want to be a householder, fine. But what's supported and strongly suggested are these blocks of time every day. And there have been cultures like this for sure. You do your chores, you get your do your meals, whatever, and then spend several hours in prayer, in contemplation, in meditation, in moving your comfort zone forward towards realization. And this is part of the routine in a monastic culture. You're able to go to visit the prayer services, the monastic culture. Are you ever able to attend seminars, able to attend retreats? You see, it's super beneficial to have a monastic culture. And it is said that householders do can be realized. Absolutely. Some prefer the monastic retreat, others householders, but householders can reach realization. The key, one way or the other, is familiarity, blocks of time. Always have this buzz, spiritual buzz going on in your life. Always have a spiritual buzz going on. And it's more than just the trappings. I know a lot of people, like from certain cultures, they have like a little area with a little shrine area or something. A lot of Catholics have some that in the house. It's just part of the decor of the house. It's okay. It's nice, but beyond the form like that, what's important is the blocks of time you put forth, where you practice, spiritual practice, a full stop in the wow of moving your comfort zone into the wow, like, wow, this is staggering, this good news is staggering, and then calming down from that naturally, full stop, calming down, watching your thoughts, keeping yourself steady as possible. So you practice this destabilization of your belief system, and then you practice trying to remain steady in that. It's like an earthquake, a psychic earthquake, a belief system earthquake has happened. And you're trying to stay on your feet, you know, and not panic. It's like that. It doesn't require a bunch of shrines and pictures of saints and all these kinds of things, you know. That can be there, but this is not required at all. You can just have a blank room or just anywhere. Wherever you can concentrate. And again, the good news, receiving the good news is the path. Receiving the good news. Now, secular culture is very different. It has a different, it tries to substitute a different kind of good news. You know, guess what today? Today you're going on a vacation. Or today, your wife looks even more beautiful. Look at the new clothes she has, how beautiful she looks or something. You know, today, the flesh looks even better, right? That kind of stuff. Today, you're going on a shopping spree. This is the culture we live in. This is the losing way, the losing way. So what we do, is today, I'm moving my comfort zone towards the good news, towards receiving the good news. Oh, existence says, I've never existed. No one has ever existed. Send out this blessing to all, say, no one has ever existed. Spirit has never existed. No one has ever existed. Okay, this is receiving the good news. Have you ever gone to work and you're busy working and the boss says, okay, everybody, we're going to take an hour break right now and we're going to work on receiving the good news that no one has ever existed. So everybody sits down, calm, quiet, not moving. No one's going to move or eat or move about. Take any cell phones, everything's turned off. Okay, we're going to drop all thought of the world, of work, of survival, of sustenance, of doing anything, of getting anything, etc. We're only going to focus on receiving the good news. Guess what? No one has ever existed. No one has ever existed. And then we work on that. And after after a while, it feels like psychic earthquake. It's just like, wow, this is rumbling through my belief system like an earthquake. And then we just ride it out. And then the next time we say this, and the next time, it's kind of like, no problem, no earthquake, or very little earthquake, less earthquake, all right? How often does that happen at your place of work? Well, in a monastic culture, that would definitely happen. You most certainly would have a good news break in your work. Good news break. See, it wouldn't be life would not be about the GDP, but the stock market or stuff like that, okay? So how nice would that be? Receiving the good news. Everyone must receive the good news eventually. Everyone, without exception. Without any exception. The highest diva in this whole dream of existence. The highest diva. The most entitlement demanding diva there possibly could be. No exceptions for that diva whatsoever. No exemptions whatsoever. That diva has never existed. No one has ever existed. Existence has never existed. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. Truth is true and nothing else is true. So, monastic culture, you have these breaks. And you may have several shorter breaks at work. It's not all about efficiency. It's not all about productivity. It's about receiving the good news. It's about responsibility. And receiving the good news is our responsibility. It is our spiritual responsibility to receive the good news that no one's ever existed. I'm not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. See, that's the real good news. Now the secular, materialistic paradigm, again, is all about glamour, it's all about glitz, it's all about attraction to bodies, form. And it keeps trying to tell you good news, too, you know. Here's a pill. Good news. We have a pill for you. We're going to boost your testosterone. We have all these medications now. Good news. You see, that's not the good news. So we're not hearing the good news in secular humanist materialism. Materialistic culture. This culture is a spiritually bankrupt culture. It's spiritually bankrupt. All right. Plain and simple. The good news, nothing has ever existed. This table doesn't exist. This table has never existed. This walkway doesn't exist. This walkway has never existed. Now, instead of trying to turn ourselves into Amazons and heroes, we can walk, we can practice. If we take a walk for exercise, practice, this road has never existed. This road does not exist. This road has never existed. This day doesn't exist. This day has never existed. And you can do spiritual practices like that. Slow down. Monastic culture slows down. you can stop. You can take a break. You don't have to finish sentences or communications. You give everyone the space for the wow. There's space and for the wow. Talking and just wow. And you can just space out on the wow. You can full stop on the wow. Everybody, you know, acknowledges that, right? Someone is just sitting quietly. Somebody's leaning against a lamppost, just quietly, watching everything go by. Everyone understands. They're in the wow, full stop in the wow. Materialistic culture gives you drugs, offers you drugs. Oh yeah, you want the wow, okay, here's a drug. It'll give you a high for 20 minutes and it's gone, and then you get back to work or something, right? That's not receiving the good news. Spiritually bankrupt culture. Nothing has ever existed. I don't exist. No one has ever existed. Nothing has ever existed. This tree doesn't exist. I don't exist. This tree doesn't exist. Nothing exists. Nothing has ever existed. Existence has never existed. Existence doesn't exist. Maybe monastic household or culture is just as good as possible, because sometimes staying busy in a routine and feeling the pressure can be helpful. It depends on your personality and situation. And sometimes just being monastic isolation or that type of thing, you might get lazy. It's possible you could get lazy. It's possible, yeah. Fall into just a rut, and so you need to be challenged. The progress has to be brisk. How do you go fast? By going slower, by slowing down. But slowing down cannot be a pose. You know, you can't be striking a pose. It has to be intense slowing down, full stop in the wow of the good news. So you have to press the issue. The good news has to be pressed upon you. You have to be challenged. And you get the good news and you just stop. Whoa, there's a huge earthquake going on in my belief system. Wow. I'm just going to sit down. I'm just going to sit here. Wow. Again, the pharmaceutical culture tries to produce artificial earthquakes in our body. Through drugs, okay, trying to subvert monastic culture, says you don't need that. Here's an artificial earthquake. Caffeine can do that. All sorts of drugs do that. But that obviously is not receiving the good news. The earthquake has to come from receiving the good news, not from some drug. Otherwise, you don't carry progress, momentum, a familiarity properly. So monastic culture doesn't have drug problems, doesn't have drug pushers, doesn't have crime around drugs, any of that. Drugs are not allowed. Certain things are banned. Alcohol, banned. Stimulants, banned. You know, various things are banned. They're not allowed in monastic culture. Pornography, banned. Prostitution, banned. They're not allowed in monastic culture. These are just basic common sense. These are the vices. The vices are banned in monastic culture, of course. Common sense throughout history, this has been the fact. So it's no different now, nor will it be. There'd be sumptuary laws, of course, sumptuary guidelines for sure, of decorum, absolutely there's decorum. There's a certain decorum in monastic culture. People are not to be in a hurry. The body is covered up for the most part, is in the colors of the clothing. The clothing is muted. You know, you're not trying to draw attention to the body. You're trying to give everybody, allowing them to turn their attention away from the physicality, the body, and realize I am not a body. I am free. I am spirit as God created me. Advertising banned. Certainly, advertising banned. Certain kinds of music also banned. Oh, common sense. This is common sense in monastic culture. What materialistic culture has is extreme lack of common sense, extreme lack of pragmatism. Actually, though, they're very pragmatic in going toward their goals, which is to earn what they think is an exemption. See, monastic, materialistic culture holds out this goal that you can earn an exemption from reality. So you don't need to realize that you've never existed. Existence has never existed. You don't need to realize that. They say, no, you can. We know how to earn an exemption. Some of our top people learn an exemption. And we can teach you how to earn an exemption. This is a lie. This is the big lie. Eventually you find out you've just been lied to. Lied to yourself, deceived yourself. So they're very pragmatic in going towards that goal, which is basically to say, look, God, I'm body. I'm worshiping the body. I'm totally focused and fixated on the body. Without the body, I'm nothing. Therefore, I can't realize that the body, I've never been, I'm not a body. It's impossible for me. Therefore, you must give me an exemption. I've earned it. You know, doesn't work. Will never work. God's will cannot be changed. So, it's futile. Materialistic culture is simply a waste of time. Just wasting your time. And eventually you realize that, and it's wow. You get very upset about it, wasting all your wasted your time, so much time. Chasing after the rainbow of exemption, right? The rainbow of exemption. The rainbow of exception. Hoping to earn it by being a loyal idolatrous, being loyal, and all waste of time, all completely futile. So again, monastic culture covers the whole. It's a big umbrella. It's a big shade tree. We're able to take shade from materialism. In monastic culture, shade takes shade from materialism. And you don't have all these divas strutting around in monastic culture, which is a huge, huge help. It's not a diva culture. Materialism is a diva culture for sure. Monastic culture is not a senorita culture, not a senora culture, not a diva culture. Not aggrandizing the body, aggrandizing materialistic demands, aggrandizing glamour and glitz, and all of that sleaze of materialistic culture. I imagine, I know for sure, eventually the divas get tired of being divas, you know. They just say, wow, that's enough. No more. No mas. No mas. No mas. Even the divas will eventually want monastic culture. But certainly, because monastic culture is inhabited by those who used to have very bad habits, are trying to break the bad habits, you certainly can't allow in any agent provocateurs into monastic culture who are going to stir up those bad habits. So, of course, there has to be an element of strictness in it. You don't want to backslide. It's easy to backslide into bad habits. Monastic culture doesn't have a healthcare system which is not beholden to big pharmaceutical companies. Less is more. Less is more. There's support for good habits. There's support for slowing down. There's a wisdom culture there. But nor is it fanatical about this, you see, because it's easy to become fanatical about health, you know? It takes all your time away from God, receiving the good news that I am not a body. I am free. I am spirit as God created me. I don't exist. I've never existed. No one has ever existed. Nothing has ever existed. Existence has never existed and never will. The blocks of time for that. It's easy to become fanatical about your food, about your health, about this, about that. New agey, obsessive sort of thing. That's not monastic culture. The new age is not monastic culture. This is the problem. It's materialistic culture. Still materialistic culture. It's still diva culture, absolutely. Absolutely it is. People get completely obsessed about their vitamins. And having a, you know, glowing body full of glowing health from all the vitamins and stuff. The juices. You know, it becomes an obsession, my gosh. It's absolutely still materialistic culture. It is not monastic culture at all. Monastic culture doesn't pay much attention to the body at all. The human form is not used in pictures or advertising. ourselves, keep the body out of it, because we are not bodies. We are not bodies. We are spirit, as God created us. We're totally free, entirely free. It's not an inventive society. It's not a productive, producing all sorts of good society. It's a slow down and let me sit here for an hour or two society. Culture. Not just sitting quietly, but receiving the good news, receiving, hearing the good news, accepting the good news, getting used to the good news, getting used to the good news. Every day is a new challenge to get used to the good news. Now for those who like to work, they still work. The principle of forgiveness is in play. People take responsibility for their own, realizing that everything down to the last detail of their lives that's taking place is because they are desiring that it take place. There's no such thing as victimization, victim or victimizer. Everyone takes responsibility for their own life. There's no lawyers, okay? There's no litigation lawyers in monastic culture. This is bringing tears to a lot of eyes. Look at litigation lawyers, but that's fine. They need a good cry. They should cry. It's good for them. They need to get into monastic culture as well. It's a little difficult because they like to stir up litigation among people. Divide and litigate, you know. Promulgate the lie of no responsibility and then sue, you see. So. There are no lawyers in monastic culture. Especially the litigation lawyers. There's a place for wise adjudication of forgiveness, etc. Moderators and things like that. There's a place for those who are skillful in that, for sure. materialistic culture is sort of like the mantra, well, I'm free to be as wicked as I want to be. That's a materialistic culture. But keep in mind, we are not free to separate from reality. There is no such freedom to separate from reality. We cannot separate from our freedom. That's another way to put it. We are not free to separate from freedom. So, the effort to separate from freedom is just a waste of time and gives rise to severe continuity fear. We're not free to earn an exemption, because we cannot earn an exemption from freedom. We are freedom. We can't earn an exemption from freedom, from what we are. It's impossible. So, by all means, have a culture that has wise restrictions, that helps you break bad habits, helps you gain good habits, so you become more and more proficient at accepting the good news, becoming familiar with the good news. That's what it's all about. And hearing the good news. Hearing the good news is deeper than intellectualism. Hearing the good news sets off an earthquake in your belief system. Sets off the jitters, staggered mind. Staggers the mind. Monastic culture is a privilege. It should be a privilege. So people should have that as their aim. For example, materialistic culture has privileged situations, like, for instance, getting into Stanford University, becoming a Stanford alumni. You enter into a whole culture, materialistic culture, of entitlement and privilege, for sure. Lifelong. You have a massive network all over the world, really. Stanford alumni will always help out other Stanford alumni. It's a massive support system, meaning that you share common values, common goals, common upbringing, common education, you see, and you're part of the club. So, on the other hand, monastic culture is also a privilege, super privilege. It should be seen that way. People should align their lives so that they could get into monastic culture. And again, the main element of monastic culture is blocks of time, sitting quietly, in quietude, blocks of time in quietude, quiet mind, blocks of time. So these videos help by giving you blocks of time to help you practice, blocks. Because if you really are hearing the good news, it will bring about a very strong earthquake within your belief system, a very strong earthquake. And that takes some settling down. It's startling. It's like you're inducing an earthquake, you know. So it takes a block of time. First of all, it takes a while to get your nerve up to do this, to work at it, and then when you finally get this, wow, it takes a while to calm down from it, and you may want to keep going and have a number of aftershocks. There are often many aftershocks. You want to ride those out too. So you need a block of time. Morning prayers are like a cup of coffee, a spiritual cup of coffee, to kind of shake off the cobwebs, get you aligned with your purpose in the day. Evening prayers consolidate and affirm the progress that you've made during the day. The trouble with monastic culture in the world today is the form may still be there, but the briskness in terms of being challenged doesn't seem to be there so much anymore. You need quote unquote saints, you need realized beings as part of a monastic culture to infuse it with intensity to keep the earthquake going. You know, keep say, wow, don't settle down. Don't settle down into the form of monasticism and worship the form. Don't think this is it. No, this is just practice, culture of practice towards the goal, reaching the goal. Modern culture, like for instance Japan, you read about the Buddhist tradition in Japan and how it's become very formalistic, and I think the largest Buddhist organization in Japan, Buddhist sect in Japan, has to do with, you know, marriages, funerals, ritual stuff. There's almost no practicing monks at all. You see, that's not it. So there has to be those in monastic culture who are infusing it with intensity, with real intensity, with a realization that So it doesn't get stagnant. So it doesn't turn into ritual and formulas and like that. No, it's the path is an organic living, you know, breathing intensity. Your hair is on fire. You don't want to be reborn. You want to get free of these cycles of delusion, the cycling through all these different defense systems, all the different defensive posturing of existence, all these supposed progressions of existence, and none of them are true. None of them are true. I have never been born. I've never died. I've never been born. I am not a body. I am not form. I am formless spirit as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I am formless spirit as God created me. So in a monastic culture, instead of saying, feeling sorry for yourself and saying, oh, I can never get there, what you do is you stop and you're quiet to say, okay, I can never get there. Or like, let me just be quiet with that. Let me just practice the full stop and the wow of that. I can never get there. So everything is graceful for the mill of practice. We're not so worried about status, socializing status, trying to, no, we're just quiet mind, quiet mind, quiet mind, practicing quiet mind. And going through these upheavals, earthquakes, that the good news brings because it shakes us up. We say, wow, that's unfamiliar territory, terra incognita a little bit, shakes us up. And then we say, we need to stabilize. And we do it not so much by talk, dialogue. You're like, oh, well, you don't know. Just sit quietly, sit quietly. But it's a purposeful sitting. We're not just trying to be quiet. See, that's secondary. What we're doing is we're trying to maintain our poise, let the earthquake settle down. Just let it settle down. Not trying to master meditation. You see, that's all wrong. What we're trying to do is accept the good news. Existence has never existed. Existence has never existed. And again, what are we doing? We're getting familiar with it. You see, this is the key. You can always get familiar, start a familiarity with something. Maybe you might see something in the distance. So, oh, it's too beautiful. Okay, sit down right there. It means you're shaken up by the beauty of it. You know, the pilgrimages of prostration are designed with that in mind. It's a formalistic ritual symbolizing it. It's a symbol, but you take you one step, and then you prostrate on the ground, and then you get up and then prostrate again towards some pilgrimage site. This is mirroring the idea of familiarity, moving your comfort zone. See, moving your comfort zone. It's a very kinetic, dynamic way of doing it for those who are still very kinetic, you see. Now, that can be done. See, monastic culture has allowances for that. There are some who are still so identified with their body that they feel that they have to act it out with the body that way. So they do these prostrations or they roll, meaning step by step, slow step by slow step, they're moving their comfort zone. When the time they get to the pilgrimage site, they're ready. They're not all jittery. And for those who are not so kinetic, sitting quietly, you do it in your mind. Do it by sitting quietly. Good news is within us. See, this is a fact. It's within everyone. The good news is within everyone. It's just a matter of getting used to it and accepting it. That's it. So that's all monastic culture does, is helps you get used to, get familiar, and accept the good news that is within you and within everyone, which is there is no here, there is no where, there is no existence, there's no time, there's no space, there's no form, there's no process at all. There's no determinism whatsoever. Reality is exactly the way it's always been. Completely perfect, completely immaculate, completely free. And so we just are allowed to get familiar with this, the truth within us, the good news within us. That's what monastic culture supports. It's a support system for getting familiar with the good news. Materialistic culture completely ignores the good news, denies that it even exists, tells us that there's something way better than the good news. Which is, you can go out and do disco and boogie tonight, you know, and all your glitzy clothes and designer drugs and just party out. And materiality says, well, that's way better than the good news. Are you kidding? Just think about that. You can get Friday night, you can just go out and go hit the town like a roll of thunder. So they ignore the good news, they deny it exists, and attempt to claim an exemption. Logic claims. It's all about claims, isn't it? All about entitlement, materialistic culture. How can you game the system to put in the claim here, to put in the claim here? Everybody's trying to put in claims for, you know, for help for this, help for that, help for that. I need to put in a claim, I need a grant, I need to do the paperwork for, I need to figure out the system, game the system here. So all of that stuff. Trying to gain an exemption, claim that you're incapable of accepting the good news, or it doesn't even, therefore it must not exist, therefore I must be able to get an exemption. All futile. All these cheerleaders on the sidelines. Go, 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 you can do it. You can earn an exemption. You can earn an exemption. So the goal of materialistic society is for everyone to be cheerleaders. and boosters of materialistic culture, as if somehow that's going to work, is going to help us reach the objective of materialistic culture, which is to gain an exemption, to be able to exclude ourselves from reality. The good news is staggering, absolutely is staggering. It won't always be staggering, but certainly as we transition from material culture to a monastic culture, contemplative culture, quiet culture, good news culture, it's certainly staggering. The good news is very staggering. I've never been born. Nothing has ever been born. It's like you're sort of making quantum leaps, quantum shifts. Practice to keep your attention on the earthquake, the full stop in the wow. It's very important to realize what's going on and not let your mind drift. That's the discipline. Now, of course, my mind keeps trying to drift. Just say, no, that's not it. So just drop the train of thought. Don't find a way to complete the train of thought in some clever manner. Just drop it. So this is why I say don't go intellectual. Don't struggle with the struggle. Don't go intellectual. Don't say, when you're starting to drift and some scenario, some script is coming up in your mind, don't say, oh, how do I work this in cleverly into what I'm doing? Or how do I have a good ending for this? No, just drop it right where it is this instant. Full stop. Just drop it. For instance, like a sentence you might be talking about. Just drop it. You know, this reminds me of the time that I drop it. So I wonder how this is going to work out. You know, is how are we going to organize a drop it? Have any of the saints in the past ever drop it? Well, you know, this isn't fair that I drop it. But how am I dropping? One of the very powerful practices is to say, whatever arises, is this the vision of oneness? No? Drop it. Okay, now I'm thinking, is this the vision of oneness? No, drop it. No value. Is it no value? Is this the vision of oneness? No value. It's no value. Oh, I'm so stunned. I mean, drop it. Is this the vision of oneness? No value. But I'm not used to no value. but at least I should be of no value. Well, this isn't of no value. Wow, I get no value. No value. Only the vision of oneness has value. No, no. Yeah, I feel like I'm going back into no value. I don't think I'm making it no value. This is a no value. I don't get this out of no value. No value. How long do I have with no value? I'm stuck in no value. No value. Hey, I think I'm having this one at no value. So, this is a very powerful practice to maintain the full stop mode. It's the practice I actually was using in the times I've experienced the vision of oneness. Is this no value practice. I haven't used it for almost 8 months or so. I think I was scared that it was so effective. It scared me. It shows you the continuity for how strong it is. When you are successful, it's very frightening. I said, well, I don't think I'm ready for this. Wow, vision of oneness. Oh my gosh, this is, this is, I can't. How do I, what do I do? What? Wow. So it worked. This no valuing, it worked. So I went through a very intense period of practice, in the last 8 months or so, not as intense. And it can go like that. The monastic culture may have certainly has a calendar. Absolutely, it has a calendar. And there may be times when you go through, of the year where you're intense practice, and there may be times where you back off the practice because you've had success and you need time to just say, wow, I'm really close to succeeding. And this then brings up a different kind of wow. Wow, I can do it. Yeah, I can reach the goal. So this brings up a ton of inner earthquake. Like I'm going to succeed. This really changes your belief system, because before you said, well, I'm going to try, but now you suddenly shift and realize, hey, I'm going to succeed. And then that just is just like astonishing. It's still astonishing to me. I'm still working through this. I'm going to succeed at this. do it. And then once you realize you can do it, then you enter into a whole different consideration. Before, you weren't sure you could do it, and then you prove it to yourself. That flips the script, your script tremendously. It's like, oh my gosh. I thought for sure I was incapable. And now I realize I am capable. Then what about all this time I've spent, you know, trying to believe I was incapable? Ah, it's all self-deception, all attempt to earn an exemption. So you kind of take a step back, half step back, and say, wait a minute. What's been going on then? What have I been doing for so long? Trying to convince myself I'm incapable. Why did I do that? See, these questions arise, and then I'll have to earn an exception. Why did I do that? Continuity fear. Some schools, historic schools, have emphasized sudden enlightenment. They push for that intensely. And then they say, then adjust to that enlightenment, adjust to society, adjust to functioning, that you smooth it out, you stabilize it. They go that way. The other way is to go gradual until then enlightenment just dawns smoothly. And you feel comfortable with it, like that way. So there's two different ways of looking at it. And there's also the way of little glimpse, little adjustment, like that. Okay, so you might say there are three sort of, but they're all three of those ways are similar. The way of like a sudden school, like of Chan Buddhism, Zen Buddhism, often you just try to conceptually, you get confuse the mind, get the mind to just run to this wall, like a koan or Zen koan or something. You just finally drop all effort to understand, drop all effort to explain. You just exhaust this effort, and then you can have a breakthrough. And that way, when you have a koan, all thoughts are no value. I can't solve this. This thought doesn't solve it. This doesn't. And eventually you can have a breakthrough. But then they say, well, then there's trouble adjusting to the breakthrough, so to speak. And so it's just, it's like the difference between climbing a mountain gradually. As you get acclimatized, each step you take, you acclimatize. When you get to the top, you feel acclimatized. Now, someone else may take a helicopter to the top, and you drop them off on top of the mountain. They're like, oh my God, I'm on top of the mountain, but I can't breathe. I mean, this is, and so they have to spend a long time getting acclimatized up there before they can function. So when the one who climbs up bit by bit, gets to the top, they say, oh, I feel fine here. This is great. And the one that's been sitting up there getting, you know, helicoptered, they also maybe at that time finally say, hey, you know what? I finally acclimatized. I feel great. And so they both are acclimatized at the same time, so to speak. It's really not really an advantage one way or the other, probably. course, the real realization is there isn't any mountain. As both of them are up there on the top of the mountain, the helicopter and then the drop off and the climber, they're both up there saying, "Wow, look at this view, this is incredible. We're climatized." And then there's a further realization, like, wait a minute, this is all a dream, isn't it? There isn't any mountain. And they come back down from the mountain, and the master's there, and they say, smiling, nothing needs to be said. The master realizes, they finally realize there is no mountain. There is no mountain. There is no existence. But generally speaking, climbing that mountain is necessary first to realize, hey, this isn't it. And then, whoa, this isn't it. And then realize, hey, there isn't any mountain. Ah, this is all a dream. So sometimes reaching a dream goal is necessary for them to realize that, oh, this isn't it, and there is no dream. It's like saying, hey, I woke up from existence. Yeah, me too, I woke up from existence, wow. And then, no, wait a minute. This isn't quite it now. Oh, wait a minute. How can I awake from existence if there isn't any existence? See, awakening from existence is still completely dualistic. In fact, the desire to awaken is what brings about the sleep. Desire to be liberated from existence, from conditioned existence, that is the cause of conditioned existence. The desire to get free of a dream is the cause of the dream, actually. And see, this is the tough turnaround. This is the Adi Yoga. So we don't need to make Adi Yoga, Dzogchen, Adi Yoga all complex. It's not. It's just this final little turnaround is all it is. That's all it is. It's that awakening from the dream. At some point you realize it was my desire to awaken from a dream, which was the cause of the dream in the first place. And so this is a staggering insight. You know, it's a staggering insight. Which is why all this discipline is necessary. All this practice is necessary. Otherwise, we can't entertain this idea, this notion. Like, see, we had cause and effect reversed. We were deceived ourselves in this fundamental way. So this really hits hard, like tremendous upheaval. It tends to affect your breathing a little bit. You know, you feel there's something like emotionalism, so that's all that Adi Yoga, Apex Yoga is about, really. Boil it down, that's it. It's this complete turnaround at the end where we realize it's our desire to be liberated from the dream which caused the dream. See, we're not used to believing in this way at all. So we've been deceiving ourselves all along. So the realization is, wow, we've just been deceiving ourselves all along completely. desire has deceived us. We've deceived ourselves with desire. Truly, desire is the root of all suffering, for sure. But we don't quite understand what that means until you get to the Adi Yoga. And because we're not able to sit quietly, we then project this and intellectualize it and work with it instead of just sitting quietly with it. Because we think, wow, I'm such an advanced spiritual aspirant, I shouldn't be bothered by this. So then we misidentify what's going on. But most certainly, we're bothered by it. It's very upsetting. It's very shocking. It's very troublesome. So you need tremendous spiritual maturity to get to this point. To handle this properly. It's devastating. In a certain way. You feel devastated, crushed. It's like, wow. As far as Adi Yoga goes, it can't really be taught to those who are not ready for it because it doesn't register. It doesn't register. Whether you say it or not, it doesn't really register. It's only when you're ready for it that it registers and you feel it. An ordeal. I'm experiencing it right now, but I'm able to stay with it. It's very much like a shock. It's like a shock. Very shocking. You certainly don't want to try to force this issue one-on-one, personally, or in some group situation. Absolutely not. You don't want to do that. These videos here are free for anyone to watch or not watch. Everyone's in complete control. Stop the video and walk away from it if it's too much. Don't even have to go back to it. So. But it's when you get into some sort of group setting, a group pressure, or one-on-one pressure also, and try to force this Adi Yoga realization, that's when you can get into trouble. Trouble boils, dissipates. It's not something that is overly concerning, but it's certainly not something that should be done. See, in my case, they always say when the student is ready, the guru appears. Well, I kept saying, where's the guru? Where's the guru? I think I'm ready. No guru appeared. But then the Longchenpa appeared. I didn't know who it was at the time, but I knew it was some teacher. I knew this was some realized being. I had no idea who. And of course, Longchenpa's the preeminent expert on Atti Yoga, the final realization. So it's been a little bit over a year since that's happened. So I'm still working on it. November 4th was when this took place, and so it's been over a year. This is November 23rd, okay. So this is just a very stunning turnaround. Fourth phase, it's the fourth phase turnaround. Now, I guess the meeting with Longchenpa initiated me into this fourth phase turnaround. It initiated me into Atti Yoga. Just the presence. It's basically saying, okay, you're ready, here you go. So I guess it's true, when the student is ready, the master appears. I always thought that was not true because it never seemed to happen, but it happened, but subtly, subtly. When I was ready, of course, the miracles appear. When I was ready, Sri Sri Anandamayi Mak appeared to work through my valuing of the world. Work on materialism, to work through attraction of materialism, attraction of this dream of existence, to work through. When I was down and feeling like I'm not going to make it, Ramana Maharshi appeared, gave me a pep talk. And then when I was ready for the Atti Yoga, the final turnaround, Longchenpa appeared. But it's very simple, is internally, not externally. No teachers ever appeared externally in the world, so to speak, to me. No, I've not had that. So I don't know what the role of an external teacher is, really, because I've never experienced that. So I don't really know what my role could be in the world. I really don't know. I don't have any role model to follow. Although Sri Anandamayi gave the role model of simply enjoy the bliss, enjoy the spiritual consciousness. Just enjoy and let others see, how enjoyable it is. So that could be just the role model. But as far as being like a Dzogchen teacher, you do have to be very careful about that, for sure. You cannot just take people who seem to be interested in spirituality and force this final turnaround on them. That's not going to work. That is not going to work. You see, when Longchenpa came to me, I had no knowledge of Dzogchen whatsoever. None. Nothing. I had no idea who Longchenpa was. No interest really in any of that. Just no. So it's the master knows when the student is ready. And it may not be apparent to the world at all. I saw Longchenpa coming across this vast ocean. He was walking so beautifully across this vast ocean. And I was I was amazed. I said, how can anybody just walk across the ocean like that? It's as if there was this beautiful pathway right on the surface of the ocean. And he was just walking along this pathway across this mighty vast ocean all the way to the shore where he was. And I said, wow. He said, how? I said, how was the ocean? Was it cool or warm? What was the experience? He said, no, it's both cool and warm. I said, wow, this is some kind of teacher here. So one way of looking at the world is the initiations and being these teachers comes internally, and the role for those who have realization is to just dwell in bliss, to show others that, hey, the path is worth it. But I would be very careful in trying to push people too much. I would say monastic culture is the best bet. The monastic culture is the best bet. Give plenty of niches for people, you see, because everybody's a different place. There's four basic phases, and everyone's in different places in these phases. And you cannot force things. You cannot force things. But you can certainly make the progress brisk. Absolutely make it brisk. And so when the student is ready, the inner teacher will appear. I mean, Longchenpa, he didn't miss me at all. You know, I mean, he was aware. You know, there are great quote-unquote saviors, bodhisattvas, compassion at work, grace of God at work, aware of where you're at, aware of where you're at. And the world wouldn't have pinned me that way at all. Not in the slightest bit. Still doesn't. But the masters of Manjushri, as they call it, they thought of Longchenpa's Manjushri, one of the close associates of Buddha somehow, you know, in the spiritually, divine wisdom, quality of absolute divine wisdom. Well, they're aware. They're not fooled by appearances. They're not fooled by appearances. I mean, I have absolutely zero status in any religious way or spiritual way in the world, no status whatsoever, but that doesn't fool them. They have the all-seeing eye, the all-knowing eye. They can discern. Their discernment is perfect. But here in this world, our discernment is far from perfect. So I see the role of someone who recognizes, has recognized and made this final turnaround. Okay, it was my desire to be liberated which brought about this dream of imprisonment. Wow. Their role is to encourage. I always say your role is to encourage and inspire. Encourage and inspire. But be careful of playing the role of guru here. Leave that up to the those who have flawless discernment. Leave that up to them. It's very helpful to know that there are these bodhisattvas, these saviors of compassion and perfect spiritual discernment who are watching us, and they know. Let them do their thing. They know their business. Jesus says that our sole responsibility is simply to accept liberal salvation for ourselves. That's it. Just accept it for ourselves. I think the Holy Spirit is in control of everything. It's already succeeded with everyone. It's already been done. We're just watching a movie honoring our creativity, and so it seems to take time. It's already been accomplished. So we accept our salvation, and others see, hey, it's doable. It's doable. That's all. It's just doable. We don't have to be these big shot gurus. Okay, we don't have to be these big shot gurus. We don't have to be hidden either, but we don't have to say, hey, I'm this big shot guru, I'm gonna organize, tell everybody what they need to do, and I know I have heard spiritual discernment and blah, 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 blah. You can just say, hey, I'm experiencing spiritual consciousness. It's absolutely blissful. It's absolutely beautiful. And I did it, and I know you can do it too. But, you know, that's as far as it goes. I'm nobody's guru. There's those who have perfect discernment who are watching after everyone, watching after you. They're always attentive. The Holy Spirit always is aware every instant of your willingness, you see. So the Holy Spirit is the true guru. And there are these emanations of the Holy Spirit, so to speak. For instance, a Longjempa, a Jesus Christ, an Anandamayima, who are able to, you know, contact us inwardly, within, and help us get through a phase. Help us get through a phase. So we're helped through these phases. We are helped through these phases. So this final turnaround, I'm working on it. You can see the videos, like, wow. Now, you may not be there yet. Maybe you are, maybe you're not there yet. That's okay. But at least you sort of get this feel, overall, you know, contextual feel, like it's sinking in a little bit. And you're also practicing quiet sitting, which is the key to success. Familiarity is a key to success. So again, this realization is just hitting so very powerful. Now, again, if you're just listening to this and you're not quite ready for the fullness of this impact, it won't happen for you. It won't happen, so don't be worried about that. But in my case here, it's hitting real hard. Just staggered by it. Can't help it. Just briefly looking at it just staggers me. Wow. So this is how we've deceived ourselves. Helping to hurt. Let me help reality out. I want to help reality out. I want to be liberated from darkness. Well, that desire to be liberated from darkness is what brings up the dream of darkness. The dream of darkness is not self-arising. It comes about as an effect from the desire to be liberated from it. It's not separate from the desire to be liberated from it at all. It's the effect of that desire. See, we think that it came first, and that the desire to be liberated from it came second, and as an effect, we say, oh yeah, wow, there's that darkness, I really need to be liberated from it. That's not true. That's not true at all. See, the secret is this is hidden so strong. The discipline that helps me realize this too will dissipate. I'm just patient with it. Whereas if you don't have this discipline and have not worked your way, quiet sitting, practicing full stop in the now, you could very easily freak out. Your mind could start freaking out on you. It's similar, not the same, but an analogy would be like eating a ghost pepper, really hot ghost pepper. Once you've done it once, you know what to expect. Once you actually have practicing hot peppers, you know what to expect, so you don't freak out. But the first time I did it, I really freaked out. I thought I was going to die. I said, I can't breathe. Maybe it's going to get worse. Maybe I won't be able to breathe. You know, it's just like the mind starts freaking out. It was scary. It's a near-death experience. But then once you realize, oh, okay, this is how it goes. It builds up, it builds, it builds, then it plateaus. And once you reach the plateau, then, okay, that's it. And it stays at this plateau, and then it slowly mellows back, mellows down, slowly mellows down. Like that. Then you say, oh, I'm not going to freak out. Okay, of course it's intense, but there's no freak out. There's a calm there. There's a familiarity there already, and you know what to expect. Familiarity means you know what to expect. That's huge in maintaining your calm. Huge. So, even though this is hitting real hard, I'm just saying, okay, yeah. It's fine, it'll just plateau. There'll be some aftershocks, but it'll get plateaus. Now the worst thing is to try to develop spiritual powers, okay? Because then you will try to ignore the full stop. You know, thinking that you're going to attain some kind of city or power, spiritual powers, this is when you get into big trouble. Okay, so I should say this, that in no way am I advocating trying to gain any sort of spiritual powers whatsoever. In fact, there was no focus on that whatsoever, really. Occasionally, incidentally, in chatting, by blah, 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 but no focus, no attempt whatsoever to attain any sort of spiritual powers. I could care less. That's very important. It's the foolish who are, those are what's called the dark side. Those who take the spiritual path and attempt to gain some sort of spiritual powers. This is what the Nazis did, but the real, they felt there were these inhabitants who lived underground, who descendants of the Northern Kingdom of Thule, who have the ability to accumulate this psychokinetic energy that makes them like super beings. And the Nazis felt they were trying to get the secret to how to do this from these people, and they were searching for these people. And they felt that by getting this vril, the psychokinetic energy, they would be able to be a race of super people, a super race, an Aryan super race, and be able to conquer the entire world and rule over it. Okay, very, very bad stuff for sure. That is not the spiritual path. And yet there are those who have fallen into that. I think Buddha is recorded as saying somebody walked across the water, a river or something, but they had to do a lot of meditation. They were meditating for so long, and finally they walked across it. And Buddha said, why didn't you just take a boat for a penny? You know, there's a boat right there. Just take the boat. Don't. Never go into the spiritual path trying to acquire any sort of powers, spiritual powers whatsoever. This is materialism. Look at the Nazis, it's super materialistic. This is the demonic realms, those who are trying to cultivate. Well, why would you want to cultivate spiritual powers in a dream? Why not just wake up from the dream? Why not let go of the desire to wake up from a dream, which is what's causing the dream in the first place? Certainly, if you're into cultivating spiritual powers in a dream, you're not going to want to wake up because you think you can dominate the dream. That's not how that's going to make you happy. There's a phase where you might look at, study the spiritual, all this stuff. And that's just interesting, levitation and walk, you know, walking real fast and be able to cover large distances and by location, blah, 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 blah. So what? Are you free of desire to liberate yourself from a dream? Right? If you're not, you're still deluded. Doesn't matter if you're levitating. Not a body, I am free, I am spirit, still spirit as God created me. Why do I need to be working on trying to levitate my body? I'm not the body anyway. That's the realization. I've never been a body. I've never even existed. Why am I working to augment existence when I can realize I've never existed? No one's ever existed. So, of course, full stop, meaning don't be thinking about, hey, what kind of powers can I get from this realization? Actually, that has not even occurred to me in any of this, but I should mention that, because it could occur to people, sure, in earlier phases it does. The fourth phase is characterized where that doesn't even, question never even arises whatsoever. My thoughts have never even gone in that direction. Not even once during this fourth phase. But it's worth noting that certainly, full stop, just drop. I wonder what kind of, is that not the vision of oneness? Stop. Drop it. Not the vision of oneness, drop it. The goal is the vision of oneness. It's the only goal. And the goal is the vision of oneness. And you will recognize it when you see it. say, well, what kind of spiritual power? Drop it. Whatever the Holy Spirit wants to do, it will do. It doesn't matter. Just enjoy spiritual consciousness, that's all. Ramana Maharshi insisted that he never did any miracles, didn't do anything. Insisted, although all sorts of stuff took place. He said, I don't know, I have no knowledge of any of this kind of stuff. I'm not doing any miracles. That should be a good guide like that. You're not aiming to be some kind of wonder worker, some kind of magician. Aiming to realize I've never existed. I have never existed. I am. Never existed. I am. Okay, so this has been a block of time. You see how we've used it very well. And so you're doing it. You're doing it. This is how it gets done. This is how it gets done. This is the right use of time, right use of mind. Right use of time, right use of mind, global challenges. I started this global challenge. Didn't fly, but nevertheless, it's still here. We need to have a goal by July 2016. You know, for me, I want to finish the fourth phase before then, for sure. For sure. I don't know exactly what that means, but I want to feel like that, you know, I'm not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit as God created me. I want to be in spiritual consciousness, I want to be enjoying it before that time. I want to be familiar with enjoying spiritual consciousness by that time. So that means I need to get into spiritual consciousness before July 2016 so I can get used to it. And I really need to start getting used to it. Because by that time, the world will need those who are used to dwelling in spiritual consciousness. They absolutely will need those. So I need, you know, some time before then to get used to it. What do we have left? About a year and a half? December, January, February, March, April, May. Just a little more than a year and a half, yeah. Maybe about 19 months or so. So yeah, time for me to enter into spiritual consciousness so I can start getting used to it. And then by July of 2016, we will see what happens. That's the way I look at it. We will see what happens at that point. Okay, very great block of time, huh? That's it.